Hello friends. So today we are going to start module D of retail banking because some of the chapters have been moved from module D to module E, and module D and module E has been merged. Therefore, a new module E has been created, that is called digital banking. So we'll do digital banking also after this video. So you can stay tuned with me. Okay, so moving ahead. Third party distribution in retail banking is very important because customer needs beyond the banking. Okay, that means customer they require, there's not banking is the only not the, their choice. Their choice is beyond this also. Like what their needs are there, like insurance is there, other investment needs are there. Customers also have to approach different service provider for their different needs, like investment in mutual fund and their services like broking services and demat services. So what bank has started, bank can offer the above services through relevant service provider through agency arrangement with them, because bank themselves they cannot offer these type services like demat services there and broking services there and mutual service fund there. So through the service provider, okay, means through agency arrangement, banks have started giving this type of services. And this concept of selling product other than banking product is called para banking. So what is para banking? Para banking is nothing but like other than banking services, like you are giving insurance, you are giving investment opportunities in mutual fund, you are providing services like broking services, you are providing services like demat services. So other than banking services, whatever services banks are offering, that is called para banking. So this term is very important, you can keep in mind. Okay, so what are the third party product distributed by the banks? These are here. So that means marketing of life insurance product of the insurance companies. I'll repeat once again, marketing of life insurance product of life insurance companies, marketing of non-life insurance product of general insurance companies, and distribution of mutual fund schemes of various mutual fund houses, offering of demat services, offering of broking services, and mutual fund distribution offer good scope for augmenting fee-based income of the bank. That means now the mutual fund distribution is offering very good income for the banks also. And sometimes also this new fund offering is there, then bank the arrangement, this mutual fund distribution also. Okay. Okay. So when bank, they sell mutual fund scheme, the customers and bank, they should understand this term is called propagate. So propagate is a short form of that. So this is a model of distribution. Okay, so number one is the product is there, risk is there, opportunity of return is there, people are there, because you have to ultimately give product to people. Appetite is there, so appetite means purchase to, appetite for the product. Geography means location of the bank is there. Attributes are because product may having different attributes are there. And for the distribution of the mutual fund, training is required. You have to educate the customers. Okay. So now a new term is coming up, that is called cross-selling. Okay. So what is cross-selling here? So cross-selling is nothing but it is selling one or more additional product to the existing customer base, so as to generate more business and profit per customer. Okay, so I'll repeat here. It is selling one or more additional product to existing customer base, so as to generate more business and profit per customer. Okay, this sometimes in descriptive type, they will describe and they'll say which of the following is the cross-selling. So you have to remember the total, this meaning of this para. Okay, so it is selling one or more additional product to the existing customer. Okay, and how you will carry out the cross-selling, that means searching thyself, means thyself means you search the customers, customer mining will give defined clue for the cross-selling, because you have to understand the need of the customer. Okay, so you have to search from the customer database. Okay, so it is generating new additional retail assets from a liability. Okay, if the bank is able to sell an asset product like housing, car, education loan to a saving current account deposit current holder successfully, then it is called cross-selling. That means a customer is having only saving or current account with your bank, and you are able to sell means any asset product like housing. You are able to give the house loan, you are able to give the car loan, or his child is going for the higher education, so you are able to offer the education loan. That is called cross selling. Okay, so just one data is here. That means in India cross selling is not so has gone up, but in foreign countries like you say in US, and cross selling is 2 for US, and in UK it is more than 2, it is 2 per customer. Okay, and France it is 2.5, so it is per customer. Okay, so research study observed that selling 3 product to a customer have already holden increased profitability up to 500%. This is the data. That means if you are able to 3 average, as an average I am talking about, so if you are able to sell 3 product to a customer who have already hold increased profitability, that means you can go up to 500%. Okay, so why cross selling is required? Cross selling is required because the cost factor, because customer is already coming to you and he has access to the bank, so it becomes the cost factor and profit is there, and it foster brand loyalty because customer are there attached to your bank, so they may having loyalty. So that means this is, and it helps bank to plan, implement and maintain better customer relationship management program, CRM. So this is the main motive of the why cross-selling is required. So I repeat here, with the cost factor, okay, and it is profitable and it is brand loyalty. Now here the lender appraisal procedure means why lender appraisal is required. So before the loan application, that means when application is given by the lender, what are the process up to the disbursement, that means information acquisition. First of all, we have to seek all information about the borrower. So that means when the borrower is giving you the application, you have to seek all information about the, like what is his income, what is his background, how he is paying, going to pay the EMI or whatever there. So that is first step, it's called the information acquisition. Then is the credit appraisal and sanction, means you have to carry out the credit appraisal, and then finally the disbursement. So three steps are basically divided into 3 parts. Then what are the appraisal procedure? Okay, so appraisal procedure begin with an application from which normally contains, okay, that means I already said here, like personal information is there, employment information is there, loan information is there, financial information is there, existing property details, okay, and if any other property is there, LIC policies, their gender details are, then appraisal is there. So these are the appraisal procedure we have to carry out. Okay, the next, what are the agreements, latest application form required for the appraisal process? Okay, like I'll just talk about the housing loan application there, then appraisal form is there, then term loan agreement for the housing finance is there. Okay, if it, just I'm talking about finance, this term loan agreement for the housing finance is there. Then guarantee agreement, if it is required, if you are taking some guarantor, then guarantee agreement is required. Then arrangement letter, term condition for housing finance is there, equitable mortgage intent letter. And if it is going to housing, so you have to go for the equitable mortgage also. Then equitable mortgage confirmation is required. Letter of undertaking where finance is available for purchase of the plot. Letter to be addressed by the borrower to his employer that he is going to take a loan from so and so bank. Letter to be addressed by the borrower's employer to the bank. And a letter when applicant himself is a trial officer. Mortgage deed is required in case of registered mortgage. And mortgage confirmation letter is required. Documents connection with place or the securities wherever the cable is required. Next comes the appraisal form for a home loan. Okay, so eligible loan format is there, service eligibility is there, age is there, legal opinion is very much required, valuation detail is required, inspection detail is required. Then you have to clearly specify what is the rate of interest there. Then security details are there, the repayment details you have to mention, and other charges if you are taking that you have to clearly mention. Then litigation details, if it is there somewhere you have to mention. Relaxation concession, if you are giving to any customer, then you have to mention that. And lastly, disbursement details, how you are going to disburse. Okay, now we'll discuss what are the repayment holidays. So repayment holidays may be allowed for a home loan when the construction is undertaken by a reputed builder, okay, or a government agency, and the borrower makes payment in the stage over the construction period, that is called moratorium. So moratorium period be up to 18th month from the first disbursement of the loan or 2 months after completion of the construction. So you have to remember this, this very, very important point I will highlight here. So what is moratorium period means? It is 18 months from the first disbursement, keep in mind, not the last one, or 2 months after the completion of the construction. Okay, so this is the or here or is there, you cannot take both. So this is called repayment holiday. Moratorium means nothing but where the customer does not pay any interest or principal. That's called moratorium period. Okay. And interest payable over the period of loan is calculated and added to the loan amount to arrive at the total payable amount. That means during the moratorium period also, interest is calculated and added to the total amount. Okay. And after that, EMI is set up. That means whatever interest is earned, that is added to the principal. After that, EMI is set up. Okay. So until the final disbursement and repayment commence, the borrower pays interest on the portion of loan disbursed. This interest is called pre-EMI interest. That means even though customer is not paying, but this pre-EMI interest will be added to the principal. Okay. Then we'll say what is floating rate of interest. So floating rate of interest is the total dues to the lender that will keep on changing, because nowadays they are making annual basis. They change the floating rate of interest depending upon the LRR, whatever is there, MCLR. So this is called a floating rate of interest. Okay, this is also fixed rate of interest, but now the fixed rate of interest is not popular. And number of installment is increased or reduced depending upon the change in the total dues. Okay. And one more time is coming. What is checkoff facilities? Checkoff facilities. An appropriate worded irrevocable authority for making salary deductions and remittance to the lender should be taken from the borrower. That's called checkoff facility. That means directly from his salary account, the amount is deducted. Deducted means EMI is deducted from his salary account. Okay. So, in order to ensure prompt repayment of home loans, lending banks obtain post-dated checks. Now, this has become this old-fashioned. Now, they are taking the mandate. Okay. So, ECS transactions are done nowadays. So, the date is fixed by the mutual understanding, like 5th of every month, 10th of every month. So, ECS is carried out. Okay. Now, we'll see how the mortgage of property is carried out in case of immovable property. So, immovable property is accepted by bank as security, usually by way of registered or simple mortgage. Okay. So, that means we can even register also, and we can do for the simple mortgage also. So, registered means registration is done with the registrar or sub-registrar. Simple mortgage means only you have to deposit the title deed. Okay. So, deed of mortgage is required to be registered with the concerned sub-registrar or registrar of the assurance. Okay. In case of registered. Okay. By paying applicable stamp duty and registration charges. But what are the conditions? Within whose jurisdiction the whole or some portion of property to which document relate is situated. And what is the time period? Within 4 months from the date of execution of registered mortgage involved, preparation of mortgage deed duly witnessed by two witness and payment of ad valorem stamp duty and registration update. Okay. And next, mortgage by deposit of title deed. This is very popular nowadays. So that means whatever title is there, title deed is there, you have to deposit with the bank. So essential requirement of mortgage by deposit title deed is that there must be debt existing or future. Means you have to come to agreement of debt. So whether it is today or tomorrow, there must be deposit of documents title to immovable property. Deposit must be made in one of the notified town. And deposit must be made by the mortgager or to his agent with the mortgagee or his agent. Deposit must be made with an intent to create a security for the debt. A letter of intent should be obtained. Necessary entry should be made in the document register. That means it is very, very important. Whenever you are taking some title deed, you have to make the entry in the register. The entry is done by the bank. Okay. Now we'll discuss what is the priority of charge. Now we'll discuss here which charge will have priority over the other. That means here we have two charges here. That is one registered and one is a simple. So where a mortgagor create more than one equitable mortgage over the same property in favor of two financing institutions, the institution in whose favor the mortgage is created first has priority of charge. That means now two equitable mortgages has been created. That means we are comparing two equitable mortgages. So that means the which has been created first had the priority over the other. And where the mortgagor has created separate registered mortgage charges over the same property in favor of two or more financial institutions, the priority of charge be determined with reference to the date of execution of the deeds, which has been duly registered within 4 months of execution. Okay, not the date of registration. That means in that case, we have to see the date of execution of deeds. Understood? Not the date of registration. So here, date of registration is not important. We have to see the date of execution of the deeds. Okay. Which has been duly registered. Okay, next come where the mortgagors give the same property in equitable mortgage to one financial institution and one registered mortgage to the other financial institution. The priority of charge will be determined with reference to the date of deposit of title deeds in the equitable mortgage and the date of execution of the registered mortgage deeds. Okay. So same now when compared different means one equitable, one registered. So in that case, we have to see the date of deposit of title deed and next is the date of execution of registered mortgage deeds. Understood? So this is the priority. So in equitable mortgage is no way gives inferior right compared to the registered mortgage. Okay, next come. Where immovable property of which land is the main constituent is taken as security, either primary or quoted, either by way of registered mortgage or equitable mortgage, the following aspect should be taken into account. Okay, so number one, the tenure, number the valuation and the title of the deeds. Understood? So this was all about the mortgage. Now, what are the post-sanction activities bank has to carry out? Number of the monitoring, very, very important. How the fund is being used by the borrower. So, this is very, very important. Okay, monitoring is there, then inspection is to be carried out. Then, lastly, is the recovery. Recovery is very, very important because so that the account should not go NPA. Now, one more time is coming here. Restructuring circumstances when a restructure may be considered. That means, now, why restructuring is carried out? So, if one unforeseen event is there, major illness is there, social function requiring significant outlay of fund in the family of borrower or any other circumstances that affect the repayment capacity. Because when the borrower is defaulting and in that case, restructuring, that means we may increase the tenure or we may decrease the tenure or may decrease or increase the EMI also. Okay, so this is called restructuring. So how restructuring is carried out? In case of salaried class borrower who are in loss of pay due to lockout, strike, disciplinary action, delayed payment of salary by the employer. So because the genuine reasons are there, so we can do the restructuring. We can give this more time. We can extend the time period for payment of the EMI. Okay. And delayed completion of housing project. Maybe many reasons are there. Some strikes are going on. So the builder is not able to complete the project. So we can give the restructuring. Okay. And death and disability of the borrower. Sometimes what happens, this borrower is having some death or disability is there. So we can restructure. Okay. However, one more very important point. Willful defaulters should not cover under the restructuring program. So the person who is not willing to pay, that means they will not come under this category. And one more thing is that credit rating should be reviewed annually. So we keep on seeing the credit rating also. Because some borrower may be having some other loan also, some other bank, or they might be approaching, or they might have taken the loan from other institutions also. So we must see the credit rating of the borrower also. Now we'll see next chapter is called securitization. So securitization means conversion of existing or future cash inflow to any person into tradable security, which then may be sold in the market. Okay. So what it means securitization, I repeat once again, securitization means conversion of existing or future cash inflow. So how future cash inflow will be there? So it may be due to the security which is available in the bank. Like one borrower has given mortgage of the house and the house is giving the rent. And so that is called the, that means now bank is getting the rent as a profit. So this is called cash inflow. Okay. So that is called mortgage backed security. In short, we say MBS. Okay. So I'll repeat once again here. What is securitization? Securitization means the conversion of existing or future cash inflow into a person into tradable securities. So that means security means like just like, you know, security market, no? They will share will be issued, then may be sold in the market. So the market players have different characteristics relating to. So market players means those who are entering into the security, that means those who are buying the security. What the characteristic they may be having, they may be risk appetite, because sometimes out of, you know, the whatever securities with the bank that may be incur in loss. So they have to be keep in mind that risk appetite is the main factor. Maturity is the main factor. What is the maturity of the mortgage security and return expectation? That means that whatever the security is a bank that must have return expectation. And I told you the like rent. And then periodicity, what is the periodicity of the return? Monthly, quarterly, yearly. And then a liquidity of the promissory note. So whatever the promissory note has been issued by the bank, that what is the liquidity of that? So how the mortgage backed security is structured means how they are structured. So it must be unique and would depend upon the following factors. Number one is the quality of home loans. I gave the example of home loan only. So what is the quality? Security value and receivable quality. And history of collection and delinquency. That means how the rent is coming. That means what is the history? Home loan lenders credit rating. Okay. And probable rating for the proposed security by rating agencies. Some external agencies are also there. Rating agencies, they carry out the rating of that. Okay. Then issue cost, including credit management cost, test management cost. That means when security is being issued, the bank has to take the various factors. That means some credit test management cost is also there, including credit enhanced cost is there, because bank also ultimately has to get some profit out of that. So what is the concept of securitization? Okay, the process of converting mortgage loan, maybe any loan of that matter, together with the future receivable into negotiable securities, okay, or assignable debt is called securitization. That means, okay, I'll just take example of let a bank is having one home and bank is getting the profit out of the rent, as a security. So that security may be sold to the other person. Okay. Other person. Maybe in one part, because let the cost of one house is 1 crore rupees, but that person is not able to purchase whole 1 crore cost. So, but it may be broken into security. Means like maybe 100 rupees, 100 rupees, 100 rupees like this. Just like a, we take about the share market. In the like. So this is called securitization. So securitization is a process by which a selected pool of homogeneous. So bank have many houses. So they will create the pool of houses. So securitization is the process by which a selected pool of homogeneous and quality credit asset of a lending institute is sold to investors through a trust intermediary by packaging them in the form of securities. Okay, that means out of a pool of assets, maybe pool of homogeneous credit asset, one security is sold. I mean, in equal shares, right? Just like a share market. Now, shares are created and they are sold to the investors. So, it's called the securitization of the. I think this now point is very, very clear. Okay. And which are transferred by way of पे थ्रो सर्टिफिकेट, पीटीसी इज कॉल्ड पे थ्रो सर्टिफिकेट बाय अ पास थ्रो और पे थ्रो सर्टिफिकेट, पीटीसी इशूड बाय द बैंक टू दैट इन्वेस्टर्स. ओके एंड दिस एसेट बेस्ड सिक्योरिटी, नंबर वन वी डिस्कस द मार्केट बेस्ड सिक्योरिटी, नंबर वन द एसेट बैक्ड सिक्योरिटी कैन बी स्ट्रक्चर्ड इन टू डिफरेंट वेज. नंबर वन द पास थ्रो स्ट्रक्चर, नंबर टू इज द पे थ्रो स्ट्रक्चर. सो पास थ्रो स्ट्रक्चर जनरली यूज फॉर लोन्स विद अ टेन्योर ऑफ मोर देन वन ईयर, सच एज कार हाउसिंग लोन, है ना, बिकॉज टेन्योर इज मोर देन वन ईयर, है ना. इन ए पास थ्रो स्ट्रक्चर मीन्स पास थ्रो स्ट्रक्चर अ बंच ऑफ लोन आर कन्वर्टेड इन टू एबीएस. ओके एसेट बैक्ड सिक्योरिटी, द मेच्योरिटी ऑफ एबीएस इज यूजली कंपेरेबल टू द टेन्योर ऑफ द लोन्स. ओके दैट मीन्स वी हैव टू कंपेयर ना, इट इज नॉट यू इशू द एबीएस मोर देन द टेन्योर ऑफ द लोन. रिटर्न्स ऑन एबीएस आर पेड डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम इंस्टॉलमेंट ऑफ द लोन्स. ओके बिकॉज यू मस्ट बी गेटिंग द इंस्टॉलमेंट ऑल्सो, सो आउट ऑफ दैट यू मे पे द रिटर्न टू द installment of the loan, or you may be getting the profit out of the rent also. So out of that only, whatever profit you are getting out of that asset, from that asset you will pay return to the ABS holder. Understood? That means investor. So how investor will be getting the return? That means he will be getting return from the installment or whatever income from the asset is there, he will be getting the that returns. Okay. Next is the pay through structure is generally used for the loans of short maturity. So this is a big difference, keep in mind, right? Pass through and pay through. Pass through is the more than 1 year and pay through is a shorter maturity, such as credit card receivable, right? Okay, now we discuss mortgage backed security. So mortgage backed securitization, the home loan assets are bundled into securities and sold to investors, right? They are called mortgage backed securities because the pool of receivables sold to the special purpose vehicle is supported by the mortgage home loans. Okay, so MBS have not been popular in India. There are many reasons why MBS is not popular in India. So many two reasons are here. Okay, number one, lack of stringent foreclosure law, because India the laws are very stringent, so foreclosure law are very stringent, so that means the investors are not very attractive towards this. Okay, and next factor is the conversion of asset into security attract high stamp duty. So that's why cost become more. So when cost become more, then the profit earned by the investor become less. Okay, so in the case of NHB, the process of securitization of home loan receivable work as a two-stage process. So we'll say what are the process NHB. So I'll repeat once again here. I'll just repeat here. Then securitization of mortgage debt. How this finally securitization is carried out. So NHB special purpose vehicle may purchase and convert the housing loan into security and PTC stand by pass through certificate concurrently and issue them in the capital market for investment by investing institution. That means then you have to go to the capital market where the investor they invest their money. Now for this purpose, one MOU has to be signed by the bank and NHB, right? Because bank may be having a housing loan, but NHB is creating the securitization. So there must be one MOU, right? MOA, memorandum of agreement with the NHB. Okay. So based on the willingness to sell or securities its portfolio of housing loan, the primary lending institute, that is bank. Okay, so bank primary lending institution means bank is required to enter into umbrella agreement. Okay, umbrella agreement, keep in mind, called memorandum of agreement with National Housing Board, na, to sell securities its portfolio of housing loan. Okay, and the memorandum of agreement encapsulates the entire MBS transaction, MBS, mortgage based security, and entitles NHB to take necessary step to purchase our securities at identified pool and housing loans, including calculation of information memorandum and collection of subscription amount from the investor. Then the responsibility comes to the National Housing Board. Okay, that means whatever pool of securities held by the bank, it is sold to the National Housing Board and under the agreement of memorandum agreement, then it is sold as a security in the capital market. Now comes how to select the pool of housing loans. So pool of housing loans would be selected by the primary lending institution from its existing housing loan based upon the pool selection criteria, because a lending institute may be having many housing loans. So every housing loan cannot be selected, no, because so based on the, that means valuation and a pool selection criteria and a pool selection criteria they will follow. So they have to carry out the valuation of pool and considering the assignment. So NHB will consider the making payment for purchase considering to the primary lending agency under the following methodology, because now NHB has to pay, and because the primary lender they are selling. So NHB will consider the making payment to purchase consideration to primary lender agency under the following methodology. Number one, the per pricing methodology, you know? Then premium pricing methodology, then discount pricing methodology. So because they have to value this property, based on that they will purchase this, okay, as the securitization process. Now there is one tax benefit is also, if one borrower is taking one housing loan, so he will get some benefit also in that, in filing income tax. So in respect of loan taken for purchase construction of a residential unit, the borrower can avail benefit of payment of interest as well as payment of principal. Okay, the interest on housing loan can be claimed as a deduction from income from property, okay, salary, business, profession, capital gain or any other source, up to maximum of 150,000 under section 24B. This is very, very important point I am just highlighting here. Okay, under section of the income tax, every year subject to the fulfillment of following conditions are here, na? Don't say that, because income tax rule keep on changing every year. So they have given some conditions, na? What are conditions here? 150,000 under section 20, but what conditions are there? Number one condition, you can see here. Number one condition, loan must be taken on or after 1st April, on or after 1999. That means fresh loan, this law is applicable. That means the borrower, they can claim 150,000 under section 24B. Okay. And number two condition is that loan is for purchase or construction of a residential property or as a refinance, you can say take over a principal amount outstanding under the loan taken earlier for purchase or construction of residential property. However, in case of loan of construction, the construction should get completed within 3 years of raising the loan. Okay. Deduction can be claimed only from the financial year when the purchase construction is complete. It's a very, very important point. Okay. That means the construction should have completed within 3 years of raising loan, and deduction can be claimed only when from the financial year where the purchase or construction is complete. Huh? Like you can say, if the construction is complete in December, just coming 2021, so from this year, this financial year, okay, from this financial year you can claim 150,000 under section 24B. This point is very, very important. This 24B is Income Tax Act. Okay, so now moving ahead, next point is here, that means in any of the first two conditions mentioned above is not satisfied, that is loan was taken before that, a loan is for the repair, loan was detection only up to maximum 30,000 every year can be claimed. Okay, now I'll clarify here. So if any one of two conditions are not satisfied, so you cannot claim the loan. That means it must be before, that means loan is taken before 1st April 1999, because I just stated here, loan has been taken on or after 1st April 1999. Okay, so that means, and if it is before loan, that means no, you cannot claim. And one second condition is that it must be completed within 3 years. Okay, now for repair and reconstruction or renovation, deduction only up to 30,000 every year can be claimed. For taking for reconstruction or renovation or some repair, so 30,000 every year you can claim in the same section. Okay, In case of loan is for the repair, renovation, reconstruction, deduction on amount of interest on that loan can be claimed only if the property is self-occupied or if the owner is not able to occupy the property only because of his employment, business, profession at another place where he resides in the building not owned by spouse, close blood relatives. Okay, that means this clause may be happen with the salaried people like bank people, they keep on transfer some other places. So this may happen if it is not self-occupied, but okay, but so in simple way, we say that property should be self-occupied. And if he is not able to occupy the property, it may happen due to some posting transfer, no, due to some profession and all. So no problem, he can also claim. No? So next, moving ahead, the deduction on deductions are permissible only in respect of one property of the borrower. No? But now this income tax law has changed. You can claim up to two properties. Okay. So moving ahead, you can recheck the. This income tax, you must recheck the latest guidelines, huh, because these keep on changing every year, huh, so don't go as per this wording. Okay, now moving ahead. So, valuation of real estate property, how the valuation is done by the real estate property? 1 minute. Yeah, we'll take point this later on. So, we'll just discuss before that mortgage advice, huh, because we'll do more valuation real property just now after this. So, mortgage advice in India, mortgage advice profession is carried out without any regulations. There are regulations in US, UK, and other countries, but in India, there is no such advice is there. So, this concept is being introduced in UK, 1st August 2007. The content of PAC is list of documents provided us. What are the important and compulsory documents are there? Sale statement is there. Huh? Evidence of title to prove that seller owns the property, and energy performance certificate indicating how energy efficient a house is on scale A to Q, and time value of money is very, very important, interest, annuity, receivable, this is very important. Now moving ahead, we have come across this annual, how interest has been paid, so like annually, if we are compounding that interest, then P into 1 plus R, if it is compounding annually, okay, and quarterly, then you have to divide rate by 4 and you have to put 4 power here, and I'm talking about the 1 year only, okay, then it's come monthly, then you have to divide by 12, everything you have to divide by 12, okay, because for 1 year, this will be 12, okay, this will be 12, 1 means 12. Okay, and rate of interest will divide by 12. Then what is rule of 72? So this rule of 72, everybody must be knowing, but I will just reiterate here. So what rule of 72 says, this rule allows you to determine the number of years before your money doubles, whether in debt or investment. So this is the future value of money for finding the future value. So this is the future money formula, it's called FV. So how to use the rule of 72? So that means whatever the rate of interest is there, what we'll do, we just that means in how many years the money will divide, so divide 72 divided by rate of interest. Okay, so that is if rate of interest is 9%, so 72 divided by 9. So that means in 8 years your money will be doubled. So in this way you can use the rule of 72. Now we'll briefly brush up the future value of money. So future value money, we are using the compound formula, and a compounding formula, FV within bracket 1 plus R to power N. This is the future value money formula we can use, and this we have done already in the money before that, and we have taken one example here also. So example is here that rupees is 1 lakh invested, 5 years interest is 10%. Okay, find the maturity sum future value solution. So we can use the compound formula. Okay, so formula is F equal to PV 1 plus R to power N. You can calculate, you will get the 1,61,000. Okay, so in this way, you can remember the formula. And how to calculate the present value? So to calculate the present value of annuity, whatever the formula I wrote, just divide by 1 plus I to power N. Okay, so in this formula I written here already, so you just divide by 1 plus I to power n. So 1 plus I to power n will come here. This will give you the present value. Because present value is always less than the future value. So from the future value, just if you divide here 1 plus I to power n, you will get the present value. And same for the present value, if you want to convert to annuity, you multiply with the 1 plus I as factor. Likewise. So you will get the annuity due formula. So these are the formula of annuity. I'll just repeat once again here so that you is very clear. So what is the formula of future value of ordinary annuity? So ordinary annuity A divided by I will come here. I will come at the bottom. And 1 plus I to power n minus 1. Minus 1 separate. This is the future value of an ordinary annuity. If you want to convert into present value, just divide by 1 plus I. Okay, 1 plus I to power n. That becomes the present value. And if you want to convert to annuity due, so in the respective formula, you multiply 1 plus I. Okay, that means in the future value, if you want to convert, you multiply 1 plus I. And if in the present value you want to convert, you multiply with 1 plus I. So accordingly, you get the annuity due formula also. Okay. Now, what are the capital gains we'll cover here? Any profit or gain from sale or transfer of capital asset is chargeable to tax under the head capital gains. Okay. The capital assets means any property, whether movable or immovable, tangible or intangible. Okay. It's called the means capital. So, but following are exempted. So, following assets, however, excluded from the definition of capital asset means stock in trade, stores and raw materials. We say the one enterprise may be selling the processed raw material. This is out of the purview of the capital assets. Personal effect like you generally, it doesn't come in the capital assets. Okay. Agricultural land outside the limit of municipality or notified area. So agricultural land is also excluded from the capital asset. So what are the type of capital assets are here? So here are two types basically. Number one, short term. Number one, long term. So short term capital assets mean capital asset held for less than 36 months immediately prior to date of transfer. However, in the following case, asset held for less than 12 months is treated as short term capital assets. Okay. So these are, that means these are the 12 months basis short term and other are 36 months. Okay. That means held must be held less than 36 months and here less than 12 months. Okay. So what are the these items? Equity or preference shares, quoted as well unquoted, debenture, government securities, listed in recognized stock, same UTI or mutual fund, and zero coupon bonds. Okay. So they are excluded from the, that means they are not coming under 36 month period, they are coming in the 12 months period. Other are coming the 36, less than 36. And what are the long term capital assets? So long term capital assets means capital assets held for more than 36 months, immediately prior to the date of transfer. That means if you have purchased today and you are selling after 36 months, it will be long term. Less than 36, it becomes short term. However, following case, asset held more than 12 months is treated as long term. Same here, less than 12 months. So same are coming as a more than. So list is same. So here the list for 12 months, they'll be treated as a short term, less than 12 months, and more than 12 months, they'll be long term basis. Okay. Now, very important features we are going to do here, like regarding capital gain. So capital gain arising from the sale of residential house property, section 54 of Income Tax Act, is exempted provided the property is held for more than 36 months before the sale or transfer has purchased another residential house by utilizing the capital gains without any amount. So I'll repeat once again here. That means whatever the capital gain is arising out of the sale of residential property is exempted. Okay. If property is held for more than 36 months, means 3 years. Okay, before the sale. Okay, and you have purchased the new house. Okay, new house within 2 years. then only the capital gain will be exempted. And if this capital gain is not fully utilized for the above, then only proportional amount that is utilized will be exempt. That means if you have purchased, you have sold one house in 80 lakh and you have used only the 50 lakh, then on 30 lakhs you have to pay the capital gain. Okay. And one more very important clause, capital gains from transfer of land used for agriculture purpose, section 54B, is exempt if utilized for purchase of another land. Okay, you are selling agriculture land and you are purchasing another agriculture land, then you are exempted. But if capital gain is on compulsory acquisition, like sometimes the government acquired the land from the owner due to some project. So, capital gains on compulsory acquisition of land and building in industrial undertaking, section 54B, is exempt if utilized for purchase of another land and building. Okay. And capital gain is invested on bond issued by National Highway Authority, then also exemption is there. And one more is there, capital gains on transfer of long-term capital assets other than a house property, section 54F, is exempted provided the transferor has purchased residential house by utilizing the capital gains amount within 1 year before the date of transfer or within 2 years from the date of transfer, or construct new house within a period of 3 years from date of transfer. Okay. And if the capital amount is not fully utilized, then he has to pay the proportionate amount as a tax. Okay. So, I'll repeat about this clause and the last clause once again. I repeat here. Capital gains on transfer of long-term capital assets other than a house property. Keep in mind, capital gains long-term capital assets other than house property. Because house property we already discussed. Yeah? Is exempt provided the transferor has purchased the residential house. So, he has sold some other property, but he is purchasing a house by utilizing the capital gains amount within 1 year, okay, before the date of transfer, or within 2 years from the date of transfer, or construct a new house within period of 3 years, or before the date of transfer within 2 years from the. So, here is the within 1 year but before 2 years. This point is very important. Or construct new house within period of 3 years. Very important. Okay. So, in this way, you will get the exemption from the capital gain. Now, we have come to the last chapter. That's called valuation of real property. Very, very important. So, valuation means assessment of worth. Means we have to see what is the value of that worth of an asset or property. It is distinct from the cost. Keep in mind, cost may be different, but value may be more. There are various factors on which the value of the property depends, which refers to actual amount spent in producing an asset. What is cost? Cost is the actual amount spent in producing an asset. So, cost is related to the past, while the value refers to the future. Like income tax department, grant registration to the value this wealth tax on a basis of their technical background and experience. So, for the purpose, this department has classified valuer under the separate categories. Okay. So, because value may be due to the income generation, location, like location is very prime location, hospital is there, school is there, so road, big road is there, connectivity is there, your bus stand is there, railway station is nearby. So, depending upon the facility, the value may be different, but cost may be less. So, how this value is to be carried out? So, value is carried out means how to valuation is carried out. That means income tax department has classified valuer under the separate categories. That means there are valuers, persons are there, qualified persons are there. So, they value the property. So, what is the classification of this valuer? Immovable property, agricultural land is there, plant and machinery is there, jewelry is there. Okay, so their valuation is done by the valuers only. So, how many types of real property is there? Number one, agricultural land is there. So, what are the factors that influence the return on agricultural land? Location, soil quality, availability of water, electricity, size of holding, clear title of the land, एक्सेस बाय रोड एंड अप्रोचेस, है ना, कॉटेज और फार्म हाउस, फेंसिंग, गेट्स, है ना, टाइप्स ऑफ क्रॉप दैट कैन बी कल्टिवेटेड, दीज आर द फैक्टर्स व्हिच इन्फ्लुएंस द कॉस्ट ऑफ द एग्रीकल्चर लैंड्स. ओके, एंड हाउ द वैल्यूएशन ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर लैंड इज डन बाय, सो इट इज डन बाय टू मेथड्स. नंबर वन इनकम कैपिटलाइजेशन मेथड, नंबर वन सेल स्टैटिस्टिक्स मेथड. है ना, इनकम मीन्स हाउ इनकम इज जनरेटेड एंड हाउ सेल, हाउ द प्रॉपर्टी इज गोइंग हाई. है ना, सो डिपेंडिंग अपॉन दैट द सेल स्टैटिस्टिक मेथड इज कैरिड आउट. अर्बन लैंड, द फैक्टर्स विच हैव डायरेक्ट बियरिंग ऑन द वैल्यू ऑफ द वैकेंट लैंड आर लोकेशन, आई टोल्ड यू ना, शेप, साइज एंड लेवल, है ना, सॉयल क्वालिटी एंड वाटर अवेलेबिलिटी, है ना, फ्रंटेज एंड डेप्थ, है ना, वॉट मीन्स वेयर द लोकेशन इज देयर, वेयर द फ्रंट फ्रंट फेस ऑफ द योर वैकेंट प्लॉट इज फेसिंग. Restriction on the development, है ना, if government has posed the restriction, that means you cannot carry out the development, then naturally the cost will go down, है ना, and then encumbrance is there, where the property is encumbered or not. And valuation of open land is done by the following methods, number comparative method, है ना, rent capitalization method, building method, the method used for valuation of land with the, है ना, building or others, correct. So belting method is used when the plot size is less, frontage and more depth, means length is more, but means the breadth is less and length is more. So in that length is divided into several belts. So it's called belting methods. So comparable method, rent capitalization method, valuer methods. Na, this on the profit valuation based on cost. Development method is also there. And valuation of specified building, है ना, valuation is based on capitalization of average net profit over the past couple of years at the appropriate rate of interest. This method is also known as balance sheet method, because long building, now specialized building, like one hospital building is there at the prime location, so their valuation will be done based on the profit earned by the paying building. Okay, now we'll see this, what is the sinking fund. A fund set aside for the purpose of recovery the original capital is called sinking fund. Hana, we study this sinking fund the previous paper. So the amount to be regularly set aside out of the annual income to create the sinking fund depends on the compound interest, right, supposed to and over the life of the structure. Okay, then come to depreciation. This is very very important. Hana, so depreciation means loss in value. Hana, and there are two methods for the depreciation. Number one, the straight line method. So in this method, the depreciation is allocated uniformly over the life of the property and generally adopted for the tax purpose. How it is calculated? So depreciation means C minus S divided by N. S means residual value, and as you can say salvage value. So you subtract the salvage value, and this is the cost. C stands for cost. Then divide by number of years, so you'll get the, okay, like one asset is costing 1 lakh rupees and salvage value is 20,000. So you 1 lakh minus 20, you'll get 80,000. And if life is 4 years, divide by 4. Okay, so in this we'll get the straight line method. Number one is, this was number one. Number two is very very important, written down method. And WDV method is also very very important. So WDV method is nothing but like a depreciation, keep on decreasing. So formula is C 1 minus P to power N. Okay, C 1 minus P to power N. What is a P here? So P is the percentage change, right? C is the percentage change. So C 1 minus P to power N, number of years, you can use this formula. Okay, and C being the original cost of being, and life year, P being the percentage with depreciation change. Okay, so these are the two methods of depreciation we can use, and straight line method we are using for the tax planning. Okay, and but WD method also we are using here. Okay, so we have finished our this module D, module E, that is called digital banking, you know, digital will be covering very soon. So thank you very much watching this video, and stay tuned with me. I'll cover the question also after the digital banking is complete. So once again, I thank you very much. Have a nice day.